to keep my hope alive, but I've said too many goodbyes. Do you still hear us cry? Pick your weapons, but I hold my lens. I film these horrors so the world can see them. I have no fear, I'm no tyrant man. You signed a deal to your own end. Marching forward until we're sure we've bridged the lines between rich and poor. Standing strong, 'cause here we belong. This land was built on dreams like ours. We're standing up for peace. I'm standing up for me. We're standing up for peace. Oh, I'm standing up for me. Salam alaikum, ya Falastine. Soon you'll wake up and you will be free. Salam alaikum, ya Falastine. Salam alaikum, ya Falastine. The sun will rise and you will.
أهلا بك شهر حبيب فيك الأحبة تلتقي نرجو الهداية والرضوان بمزيد من ذكر وقيام هل الهلال بنوره بشرى لكل المسلمين بلغنا ربي رمضان شهر السماحة والغفران يا رمضان يا رمضان صيامك درب للريان يا رمضان يا رمضان ليالي كفاحت بالقرآن يا رمضان يا رمضان ليلة قدر خير ليال يا رمضان يا رمضان أهلا بك شهر الغفران
أوها وفيه You warm embrace, blessings that have come like a tidal wave. I've come to you as a broken soul. You piece me together and make me whole. I praise your name.
Assalamu alaikum, brothers and sisters. May the peace, blessing, and mercy of Allah be upon you all. Welcome to our fifth Ramadan talk show. As always, I am your host. And your dost, Ziaur Rahman. This is a weekly show every Saturday at 12 p.m., only the during month of Ramadan. In these shows, we will have Q&A, we will have some guests, read some hadiths, play some nasheeds. Now, let's introduce our Imam Sahib beside me. He's on my left, with Allah's blessing, a fine specimen of a man. Leader of our community. They call him the Big Papa in Zambia, the problem solver, the calmer, calmer of the minds. If you're feeling stressed, he'll make dua. Financial problems, he'll make dua. If you want to get married, he'll make dua. Aches and pains, he'll also make dua without doing fufu. Buy one dua, get one free. He's our Sheikh Mufti Imam Ashraf Ali Lorgat. Assalamu alaikum, Imam Sahib. How are you today?
Walaikum salam wa rahmatullah. That's quite, I knew that was coming. He has been practicing, rehearsing.
I'm not natural gifted like you.
No.
Before we start, just want to really pour my heart out. And Imam Sahib, you want to say that to all the Muslims and brothers and sisters in Palestine, no words can express their pain, what happening past couple of months.
Yeah, it's heartbreaking. You know, it's something that's unthinkable, where children, mothers, sisters, fathers, everyone losing their lives. And think in 21st century where people would be so kind, but you know, just watching the visuals, it kills our hearts. Sometimes you don't feel like eating as well, thinking that, you know, there might be a child in Palestine dying because of hunger. And there's one video which really touched me, was where a child says that she feels ugly because of the war that was happening. Wow. Before, she looked beautiful. She's only 5 years old.
Yeah.
Girl, like your daughter. Mm. But she feels ugly. But the war has done everything. Killed her father, killed her mother. But she doesn't realize that she's still beautiful. Gee. The world around has become ugly. You know, 1.8 billion Muslims, we can't do anything. It's really hard. But keep praying, inshallah.
Keep praying, keep raising the awareness.
Yeah, it's heartbreaking, you know. It's just,
I mean,
you know, people don't want to watch those visuals because they feel like, you know, why should we watch these kind of visuals? But should watch them. It's not they're purposely coming on those visuals. They don't want to come in those videos. But, you know, we should support them as we are, inshallah, as our masjid, raising money on their behalf.
Inshallah, we'll come to announcements. And we should talk about it. And we should make announcements. And we also should speak on our social media and whatever platform we have. Some of us don't. We just stay quiet. Right. So before we talk about what we normally say, how did the year go? And it's been 1 year since last talk show. It's our fifth talk show, Imam Sahib. It's been 5 years.
Yeah, it's been 5 years. I thought it was only 1 year and then that's it, done. I'll have a good sleep. But then you've been holding me for these talk shows, the meetings after meetings after meetings.
It's been
alhamdulillah. Great. No, it's. We thought during COVID that, as I said in Jummah, that during COVID, we'll just entertain people. Entertain and educate them as well. And they educate us as well. But then the response we had and how, mashallah, you know, everyone supported in the community. And, you know, that's how it made us do it again and again and again. And of course, you know, before you carry on, we have to thank all those
technicians.
Tahir, like, you know,
Ruhan, Shazam by Safarid.
You know, the amount of wires that are here, it's unthinkable.
We only had one wire when we first started.
Yeah.
And we had a Farid's phone
and
a table. That's it. This year, we're going live on YouTube as well. Just before we start, Safia Samira, behave. Right? They're watching. I think they're being naughty.
No.
Right. Safia didn't want to say, she told me not to say her name. So.
Okay.
But I told her name now. So yes, Imam Sahib, it's been...
Yes, so...
How did your year go?
My year, till October, of course, you know, before this, things happened, was good. But then, after that, it's just a roller coaster, alhamdulillah. You know, it's... this is how Allah has made this dunya, isn't it? That Jannah, where there's happiness, happiness, happiness. Jahannam, where there's sadness, sadness, sadness. Mm. Where there's this dunya that consists both happiness and sadness. We'll go through this roller coaster, you know. Our eternity is by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the way, alhamdulillah, like, you're not going to ask me that, you know, why was I about to leave for Talbot, are you?
Well,
I was going to ask you. Sorry.
I was going to come to it, but I mean, it's been 1 year since we last come on the show. It's a yearly thing. So if you can tell us, how did your year go first?
Yeah, it's... it's a challenge because, you know, every year you want to be better than last year. Mm. Be it as an imam, as a head of madrasa, you want to be better. And of course, like, you know, as yourself, as a human, as a Muslim, you want to be better, like, better than last year. So it's a challenge. It's not that we're getting any younger.
No.
We're getting closer to one day we'll be sitting here with white beards, me and you. Can you imagine that?
Me with beard? Mine doesn't grow, but I'll try.
You don't let it grow. But how did yours go?
As you said, up and down. Alhamdulillah, it's last year after Ruza.
Do you travel anywhere?
Not with the family. Me and Kukon did. We were in Greece. Traveled in the UK with the family. Did I do anything else? Last year, no, I didn't do much. This year, we're traveling, inshallah. But last year, we didn't do much. And then, obviously, this Palestine conflict happened. But you traveled a fair bit a couple of months ago, didn't you?
Yeah. I've been to a country called England. Oh, sorry. I've been to Mecca. That's one day.
Just one day?
One day in Mecca. Then I went to India as well. It was quite different. Mecca, I think one day Mecca, Umrah is not enough. Mm. Never enough. And it was different. Before, when I went 7 years ago, was it was easy to touch the Kaaba around. Mm. Mm. Besides, of course, the black stone, the Multazam. Mm. But this year, everyone was just going everywhere. Like, you know, I was getting elbowed by women as well. Yeah. Can't do anything. They know that you're not going to do anything. But, you know, one thing you realize when you're there is everyone comes with the same dream.
Yeah.
There's this brother I met. He said that he's been saving up for past 24 years to come just for one Umrah.
Just one Umrah?
One Umrah. 24 years. He's been selling milk. So everyone comes with their own dream. I've been India. India was a bit different because the cows there have attitude, man. they don't move out of the road. It's like, you know, it's like the pigeons we have here.
Yeah.
You know, in the town center, they don't even move. Like, proper attitude. Do they know you're not going to do anything?
No, because they call him the god or something.
Yeah. So it was a bit different.
Yeah.
The food as well was quite nice.
Was it clean and everything? Hygiene?
No comment. But the village one, village lifestyle is really good. Fresh air, waking up, Fajr, you know, it's really nice. But one thing to emphasize, you know, the way Muslims are suffering in Palestine, similarly Muslims are suffering in India. Mm. They are trying to demolish most of the masajid that are all masjids. They're going after every masjid, mostly. Like, you know, when I was there, I was looking at the messages that, you know, this masjid, look after this masjid, try to help this masjid. And one thing they don't mention about Palestine at all in India. Oh. Not at all. Not at all. It's like before Bayan, I had a Bayan in one of the masjids. Mm. Just before Bayan, the Imam comes to me and he says, don't make mention about Palestine. The police are outside.
Wow.
Yeah, so it's we need to pray for them. Other places as well.
Inshallah. And then on the way back, you went to Qatar or Dubai?
In transit.
Okay.
I went to Qatar and then came back.
Alhamdulillah. You're an international imam, what we should call it.
Tell me, where are you going in June?
I'm planning to go, inshallah, with the family in Egypt. But, you know, when my flight might get cancelled or something. Remember last time? My flight got cancelled.
Oh, yeah, from Bristol.
From Bristol, EasyJet. So let's see, inshallah. But yeah, this Ramadan, I was ill, man. Since Sunday.
Yeah.
From Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, I was ill. I had a really bad start.
Last Ramadan, I was 3 weeks without voice. I thought Hafiz Maruf will take some of my bayans.
Mm.
Never said once. Like, but
everything's opening up now. You didn't say that before.
No. He knows his nikah. I'll charge him double the money I charge.
Mm?
His nikah, I'm going to charge him double.
Inshallah. Remember, as a joke, I said Hafiz boy might get married last year as a joke.
Yeah.
But inshallah.
The CV's up.
Inshallah, let's make dua.
Okay.
So Imasab, you know, obviously you're one of my best friends and we talk and stuff and everyone might have the same feeling.
You know, when I came, there was this fear amongst people. I don't know where it came from, that, you know, can you be a friend with Imam?
Mm.
Remember when you went to Cardiff and people said, like, oh, I'm going to play FIFA with the Imam, and they were like...
I remember that, yeah. They're like, oh, he plays FIFA. Oh. Is he allowed?
The trophy is in Manor Street. No, that's, you know, we should, imams or any hafidh or any alim, they are humans. And to have a connection with, I'm not saying just myself or any imam who you're close to, you need to have that connection where, you know, you need advice. Allah says in the Quran, وَأَمْرُهُمْ شُورَى بَيْنَهُمْ, regarding the sahaba, whereas, you know, Allah, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he used to get wahi from Allah. But Allah still tells him that, you know, when you are doing something, invite everyone, talk to one, to everyone. Yeah. As you do, mashallah, you know, talk to people, and at the end, decision, it's you to make. And, like, you know, we should always remember the, you know, Sheikh Walid, who was here.
Yeah.
Always remember him in your duas. You know, without him, you know, we wouldn't be where we are. And all the imams that were there, you know, we all have some deficiency, like even myself, but never ever speak bad against any imam who's been here. Because you've read namaz behind them.
Of course.
Any imam anywhere, like even if you are from Bangladesh, somebody taught you Alif Bata, don't say bad thing about them because they taught you the basics.
Right.
Do you get it? So Sheikh Waleed, always pray for him this Ramadan, you know. Imagine his status has been raised in the grave, knowing that somebody from Port Talbot is reading Quran.
Yeah.
You know, Allah. Like, you know, he was your teacher?
He was, yeah.
Farid and Nixon Bhai and Shajan Bhai, all that's your teacher. So keep on praying for them.
Yeah, I mean, inshallah, because Brother Waleed was, he got me into praying namaz and Quran and all that. But yeah. Brother Waleed, I'll tell Nixon Bhai to get hold of his family because I think he's still
got
his number.
How was he as a teacher? Was he like
proper? No, he wasn't. He was good. He was good. He was really good. Alhamdulillah. But as you said earlier, that always I come for you for advice, but there's others like my sister, my Tula Bhai, my brother. No, one thing. I told you, I think it was last week, and you said some things. I guess everyone, young family now, like 35, 36-year-old, whether you've got a kid, I think they worry for their children's future. Like, I worry for my kid's future. Because I can see, especially UK, it's economically, you know, Muslim, it's not going great. And I always worry for their future, that when they grow up, how will the society be? How will they manage their life? And plus, as a father, I want to give them the best upbringing, obviously Islamic-wise, but you have to say financially as well. I want to give them a good platform, which, say, I never had. But I want to give them a good platform to start. I always do worry that, what if I can't? What if, as a father, I can't do it?
Yeah, so you have to remember there's a hadith that the word if... It's from Shaitan. فَإِنَّ كَلِمَةَ لَوْ تُفْتَحُ أَبْوَابَ الشَّيْطَانِ. That the word if opens the doors of Shaitan. Okay, and you know, like your father passed away when you were really young?
Really young, yeah.
May Allah forgive him and elevate his status. Didn't your mom had the same worry?
Yeah.
Look at her perspective. Like, how will it... I know you have older brothers, but as yourself, without a father, she had the same worry.
She did.
But were you homeless at any time?
No.
Did you not have food at any time?
No, I did.
Allah has written risk for everyone. Do you understand? So, like, the worry, it's about future which you haven't seen. You know, it's we should just keep on praying. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has written risk. So, sustenance. So, if Allah has written 100 pounds for you, you will get 100 pounds. But it's up to you, halal way or haram way.
Yeah.
So, it's up to you how you earn it. So, we shouldn't worry. Rather, we should pray for them. And don't have this if. You know, this doubt is a big disease. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that, you know, doubt is the biggest illness. Like even when I was speaking to Dr. Patel, he says many people, patients come, they're not ill, it's just a doubt. So don't have doubts, inshallah. Keep on praying. And, you know, and this should encourage you to do more for them instead of discouraging you.
Oh, Jazakallah. So basically, if...
Opens the doors of Shaitan.
Opens the doors of Shaitan. So something I learned last week, to be honest with you, and I thought I'd bring it up because I was like that. I was like, oh, if that. So yeah. So inshallah, guys, Jazakallah, Imam Sahab. Now we have to go on a break. After the break, we'll come back and we're going to speak about madrasa.
Yeah, insight about madrasa, that how our madrasa works. So
yeah, inshallah, we'll come right after the break.
Ramadan is a time for family, for community, and for reflection. It's a time to appreciate the blessings we have and to remember those who are less fortunate. The best of you are those who feed others. Ramadan is a time to strengthen the bonds of love and friendship. May this Ramadan bring you and your loved ones joy, peace, and blessings. Ramadan Mubarak from Crown Farms.
Casa Pizza, Port Harbour's freshly made stone-baked pizzas.
Ramadan is a time for family, for community, and for reflection. It's a time to appreciate the blessings we have and to remember those who are less fortunate. The best of you are those who feed others. Ramadan is a time to strengthen the bonds of love and friendship. May this Ramadan bring you and your loved ones joy, peace, and blessings. Ramadan Mubarak from Crown Farms.
Casa Pizza, Port Harbor's freshly made stone-baked pizzas.
Welcome Ramadan back. Is a time for family.
Welcome back, everyone.
Assalamu alaikum, Jawad. I got your question. How did I travel to Port Talbot and why, Tahir? Oh, why? Jawad, I came for you, Jawad. No, how did I travel to Port Talbot? Why?
Well, I know, because you told me.
Because there was no imam here, so I was desperate in need of the Lal Pashp. Then I was free as well, so that's how the match was made in heaven. Okay, we'll start with the madrasa introduction. So one thing you have to remember, I'll just start with a little bit of history. Shahjah might correct me if I'm wrong. Before I came, the madrasa was, we had about 12 students and it was only one class. By then, there was only Brother Ahmed who used to come some days. And when I came, that's how, it was quite challenging. So you have to remember, I was in Blackburn prior to this. So Blackburn, where there is large Muslim community, and there's about 16, 17, 18 classes. Mm. You've been there, you've seen the masjid, remember? Yeah. So each class has children that are same age. So when coming to Port Talbot, children were at different age. So you might have an oldest brother, youngest sister, same class. Whereas, you know, when children are in same age, they're on the same sabak. So it's easier. Whereas here it's different. Everyone is on a different sabak. So each teacher has to give different sabak to a different teacher, a different student. So the first challenge was to make sure to have children of kinda similar age, not same age, like a bit closer.
Yeah.
And I remember like I had this pressure where coming like, why are you taking on so many students? Mm. But of course I had this target that I wanted to make
take the students on and then
separate them. So it took me about 8 years to make that into four classes. And inshallah, we'll go through the introduction. So alhamdulillah, I got a very good team. And you know, I can't thank them enough. Without them, I'm nothing. I'm just the face. So next, so the next page, these are the teachers in madrasa. So that's myself as a head teacher. Then Ustad Naheed, who's the education officer. Then Ustad Riaz, deputy education officer. Apa Rabia, who's with me as well for over 9 years. She's a deputy head teacher. Apa Isha, who's the head of infants as well. So Alif Ba, she's in charge of it. Then there's Ustad Zakaria, who's one of my students and who's a teacher. Apa Iram, mother of Ustad Zakaria. Mm. She's a teacher. Then Ustad Tahir, student as well. Ustad Rehan, Apa Zainab. So Zainab Musawir, mashallah, you know. Comes from the college straight to the madrasa. Then Apa Aksa, Din Sab's daughter, who volunteers as well. So this is the long crew that, you know, one is, like even I think in your kitchen it's like that, one is managing and one is teaching. Managing is different.
Mm.
It's hard. You know, you'd rather come and teach and go.
Yeah, yeah.
But you know, managing, but alhamdulillah, they are all understanding and they're really good. So we have four classes. The first class is class Alif, where it starts from the age of five. Usually what we do is, when children reach the age of 4.5, like today, the children who have reached 4.5, they'll come for 1 hour. So we just want them to get used to it. So we have 16 students. That's quite a lot. We have to remember that. 16 students.
Per one teacher.
So the other ones, I'll explain.
Okay. Yeah.
So one teacher, yeah?
Yeah.
So 16 students, we have to remember, they're not on same lesson. They're all on different lessons.
Okay.
So in 1 hour, 16 students, we have to give them lessons, sabak, because we have 2 hours. The first hour is kaita.
Mm.
Second hour, then we work on duas, etiquettes, like even from a younger age, like how to drink, how to eat, how to, you know, how to sleep. Then we have beliefs about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because we have to remember in school or anywhere they teach them about RE. Mm. So we have to embed in them from now onwards. Yeah. Then Islamic stories. So, you know, what made me tell the class Alif teachers like Tahir, Zainab and Zakaria is why they should say Islamic stories is, because in school they hear like, you know, Noah's Ark,
they do
their version.
Yeah.
I want them to hear our version.
Our version.
Yeah, so that's the class Alif, the youngest one. That's class Ba now. Class Ba, we have 14 students. So they go on Sipara Quran, and that's the first lesson, Sipara Quran and Surahs, first hour. Second hour is Duas, Islamic laws and history, Islamic beliefs and etiquettes. So the ones that teach there are Apa Isha, who's in charge of the class, then Apa Iram, Ustad Riaz as well, who teaches some of the subjects as well. So when you come at this level, you start now introducing yourself to wudu, a little bit of namaz, because you know children reach the age of 10 now. So it's quite, namaz becomes compulsory on them. And then we have class Ta now, where children are, you know, at that age where Arman will be in that class, 16 students, where I myself teach some of the subjects. Apa Rabia was the main teacher of that class, Apa Isha and Ustad Nahid, where we teach them Quran, surah, memorization of Yasin starts from the class. So Yasin and other surahs. And then du'as, so namaz du'as now, important ones, Islamic laws, Islamic history, beliefs, etiquettes, tafsir. So we try not go into tafsir and hadith as well, so they know the sayings of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So this is the other class. Then after that is the last class, the class Ta, which is my class, where we teach Quran, surah. So we have students who've memorized Surah Yasin, Surah Mulk, Surah Waqia, Surah Kahf. Some of them are memorizing. And then there's Islamic laws and history, beliefs, etiquettes, hadith, and tafsir. So myself, Apa Rabia, Ustad Nahid, and Apa Aksa. What, you know, of course, with my experience, what I realize is, like, you know, having one teacher for 2 hours, children get tired of it.
Yeah.
So what I came up with is, after 1 hour, very the teacher swap. So there's that freshness between the students, like, you know, the teacher mood as well.
Yeah, I like that, yeah.
You know, so it's that's class that. So we have approximately about 60 to 61 students. So the foundation, what we teach on, is it involves around 5 pillars.
So let me go back. You say we had how many students?
About 60 to 61.
And how many we had when you first came?
10.
Okay, 10. From 10 to 61. Yeah. Mashallah. No.
It's but Talbot's increasing. Back then, it was 60 families.
Yeah.
How many would we have now?
We had, I think, 75 plus 80. 75, 80.
So there's more than that, I think.
Well, houses, paying
members. Yes, members. Like, you know, we have Syrian families and other members. So it involves around 5 pillars and the importance of surah and dua memorization. Because usually with questions, some questions you can just go to the next imam or you can go to Mufti Google. They will answer for you. But, you know, the surah and dua memorization, people, we want from now that they know. And there's few challenges we face, okay? So places where there is so many Muslims, as I said, it's they can have the same age in same class and it can be one lesson. But we don't have that flexibility where we can teach all the children same lesson. Second hour, we teach them same lesson. But the first hour, where it's Quran, Qaeda, Surah, we have to give them one-to-one. It's like tuition, one-to-one. We have to call the child one-to-one.
I see that.
So, you know, like teaching that and then managing other children around, like not to mess about. No. So that's really challenging. But alhamdulillah, we are managing. Not all children, thus have said that. So then the third point, actually. Teachers, we actually have our volunteers mostly. And, you know, they give their time. Like, for example, there are some like Tahir and Zainab, whoever goes to college, like they come home, quickly get changed and come to madrasa. You know, how can I thank them? You know, only Allah can teach them. But proper madrasa teachers is hard to get.
Yeah.
Proper, like, you know, the ones who have, I'm not saying that the ones I have are bad, but having someone who's experienced, it's really difficult. Somebody just can't come for 2 hours.
No.
You know, it's difficult. And it happens in community like ours, where we are less community.
Small community.
But we are helping our volunteers, and inshallah, more training, I think, inshallah, we'll work. I'm working with Shah Jahan by that, you know, how we can have more training and teaching, like, you know, how to teach children.
I think our mosque, and Shah Zahan myself can agree to that, on the committee, is we focus on teaching, more teaching children, madrasa. Which our main source of income goes on teaching and madrasa. I think mosque is, that's the main thing, right? For the, in the future of the kids. It's not just for show or have a nice, you know, chandelier, but the main thing is teaching kids. Yeah.
So it's if, you know, like, for example, if you ask Hafiz Maruf in Birmingham, you can get any Hafiz to come and teach because they live within the community.
Yes, yes.
We are still growing. Yes. So we will face this challenge, but inshallah we'll overcome that challenge over the years. Then the other one is lack of space. So usually namaz times, so sometimes we have Asr, Maghrib, Isha in one madrasa time. So that is, so usually namaz times we have to pack up way early And sometimes it takes 30 minutes. So that's what, in 2 hours, 30 minutes is God. Just gone. But inshallah, we are looking into the, I don't know, third floor or something. We need space. So once the space is done, then many children on the waiting list would be gone then. But do, you know, I would like to thank the parents that, you know, they have always been supportive. Like, alhamdulillah, got good communication.
Yeah. I think, as you said, the main thing is communicate with the parents.
Yes.
So the parents of the, you know, Potab, if you have any questions, you have any problems, any issues, please, please don't be shy to get in touch with us. You can get in touch with any of the committee members. You can get in touch with Imam Saab. So anyone, please, please get in touch with us if you have any questions. Or you can WhatsApp you in the mosque number, right?
Yes. So if you don't have the masjid number, then inshallah we'll produce the masjid number, inshallah.
Also, just want to thank, you know, the two Afas who's coming.
So the next page would be about, so children from, some insights, children start from the age of 5, but we are, but when they are 4.5, then we tell them to come for 1 hour. There's no age limit to finish. We try to finish before they reach, at the end of year 10. So year 11, they can just focus on their GCSEs.
Okay.
We hold two exams in a year, Jalsa at the end of the year. And there's £25 enrollment fee at start of every year. And, you know, that covers, like, you know, all the essentials we need. And it is a must from the committee and as a community that they should pay £7 weekly. The parents pay £7 weekly.
That £7 weekly, next week, Niaz will do a graph, so we'll explain where the money goes.
And lastly, some future plans are that Hafidh class, inshallah, alhamdulillah, currently we have one child who's becoming a Hafidh, who's completed half of the Jews already. And more activities for children. We are looking into sports and
yes.
But adult classes, Quran classes, inshallah, ladies halaqa. So these are the things we're looking into. And lastly, if you want to volunteer or help with madrasa in any way, please contact the masjid number at 0739871627. Like, one thing we need as madrasa is a caretaker. If anyone, you know, wants to be a caretaker during madrasa time. So usually what happens is, if my children will tell you in madrasa, I have to sit with my phone and camera. Yeah, just in case a child falls or something.
Yeah.
So a caretaker is someone, like, you know, can look after. But that's something, that's a suggestion, you know, where all madrasas do have a caretaker. But something, if someone wants to volunteer, that would be ideal, inshallah. So jazakallah khairan. And if you have any questions, that's the number to ask.
Yes. Jazakallah, Imam Saab. That's a fine piece of work you did there. Just want to say, as you can see, the two of us been here for a long time, right?
9 years, yes.
Yeah, 9 years. But 80% of them are volunteers.
Mm.
No, so the madrasa and everything is run by volunteers. So please, if you got any kind of time or you got any kind of knowledge, please get in touch. The more volunteers, the more better of the teaching will be.
I know people say like 4 madrasas, 4 classes, but 9 teachers. But you have to remember that there are some children that need one-to-one support.
Mm.
So there are some children that need one-to-one support. And I think I need to encourage this to the parents that, you know, you shouldn't wait for us to find out which child needs one-to-one support. It's if your child is diagnosed with autism or any other disability, don't be shy. Come to us. We'll help those child on one-to-one support. You know, it's something which really, I feel bad. Like, you know, if you know your child is going through that phase and you're not saying it to us, then it's on us to...
It affects the children as well.
Exactly. So
tell Imam Saab, then at least...
Like, you know, we have Zainab, Tahir, who are... They are very good at one-to-one support, alhamdulillah. And Rehan as well.
Talking about the... I wouldn't say they're not kids, they're older now, but they are young volunteers, like Tahir. We want to thank the parents.
Yes,
Nixon Bhai, Rehan is Mum's Lutfa, husband. Raja Zainab is Jubel Bhai and Asma Afa, and Zakaria is
Shakil Bhai and Afa.
So the parents should be really proud
that
your kids are volunteering week in, week out. As you said, Zainab's comes from college straight here.
Mm. I was telling her the other day that, you know, if, say, one child learns Alif, the whole life, she'll get the thawab of that child's getting up, reading salah, doing any good deeds, because that's how the child has learned how to read the Quran. Awesome. So these teachers, you know, what did Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, best amongst you are the ones who learn the Quran and teaches it. So these ones have learned the Quran in madrasa and are teaching it as well.
So that child, if he teaches the alif to his child,
yes,
he'll carry on from Zainab.
Yeah.
And he'll carry on
from Tahir.
Alhamdulillah, Imam Sahib. So, Jazakallah for your good presentation. You got anything else you want to say?
No, regarding this I want a break now.
Yeah, so we will. You want a water break? Someone pass him the water bottle, please. So inshallah, we need a break, so we'll come back right after the break.
Ramadan is a time for family, for community, and for reflection. It's a time to appreciate the blessings we have and to remember those who are less fortunate. The best of you are those who feed others. Ramadan is a time to strengthen the bonds of love and friendship. May this Ramadan bring you and your loved ones joy, peace, and blessings. Ramadan Mubarak from Crown Farms.
Casa Pizza, Port Harbor's freshly made stone-baked pizzas.
Ramadan is a time for family, for community, and for reflection. It's a time to appreciate the blessings we have and to remember those who are less fortunate. The best of you are those who feed others. Ramadan is a time to strengthen the bonds of love and friendship. May this Ramadan bring you and your loved ones joy, peace, and blessings. Ramadan Mubarak from Crown Farms.
Casa Pizza, Port Harbor's freshly made stone-baked pizzas.
Assalamu alaikum.
Ramadan is a time
for family,
for community.
Okay, so just a reminder, today madrasa is at 2:30 to 3:30. And all the new students, I've spoken to the parents, they should bring their children only Saturdays. I think your daughter's starting today as well.
Inshallah, yeah.
2:30 to 3:30, today and tomorrow, inshallah. Yes.
Yes. Now we're going to go to Q&A. I think everyone loves Q&A.
I don't like Q&A.
So we got a few questions today, so inshallah. One sec. You ready?
Yeah.
Ready for the Q&A. Right. I'm back. Assalamu alaikum. Can I get my travel jobs during Ramadan for a trip planned after Ramadan? Will this break my fast? And can I continue?
Injections don't break your fast. But, you know, if you're traveling after... Oh, but then there are some you need in advance, isn't it?
Mm.
So injections don't break your fast, so you can have your injection.
You can. Mm. Okay, so... Yes,
but as long as it's not in the stomach, mate.
So hands, okay.
Yeah.
Backside, okay. Assalamu alaikum. When in
congregation,
namaz, is it compulsory to read tashahud and durood, or can I not read anything and just follow the imam?
Okay, so tashahud is atahiyatu. Mm. So if you are, it's wajib to read tashahud. Atahiyatu lillahi wa salawatu. It's wajib to read. Even if you're reading behind the imam, you should read atahiyatu. Durood is sunnah.
Mm.
So if somebody doesn't read it, it's okay. But for maximum reward, we are reading durood. So you should, tashahud is wajib, and durood is sunnah. Should read.
Just, I hope that answers the question. Third one. Assalamu alaikum. Can we put the Quran on the floor, or is it disrespectful?
What do you think?
I think you can't, because it's Quran, isn't it?
If somebody does unintentionally, there is no sin. Unintentionally. And if it's just about adab and not adab, respect and disrespect. I don't think if somebody puts on the floor, they will get guna. But it's about respect, isn't it? Like, this is our Quran, the word of Allah. We hold it close to our heart. So best not to. But if somebody does, we shouldn't go and criticize them. Like, I think you've seen most in Arabs, they just put the Quran and they just put it on the floor.
But
it's not guna. It's just, we feel it's disrespectful.
I see. So it's best not to.
Yeah.
Okay, I got a question about itikaf. When I have to be in the mosque and rules and regulations. So this year, basically, when do you know any rough dates when to be in itikaf?
When to be in itikaf is last 10 days, isn't it?
So do you know when it starts?
I don't know English date. Yeah,
that's, that's fine. But do you know when it starts? I think he wants to ask a question. Is it after Asr, Maghrib, or Isha?
After Maghrib. So they come in before Maghrib, and the itikaf starts. Itikaf literally is just secluding yourself for the praying to Allah. So you're finding, you're looking for the Laylatul Qadr, the night of power.
This question is from basically Masoom Bhai. As a joke, I told him, he has to finish work come after Isha. But he's it's after Maghrib. Sorry, before Maghrib.
Before Maghrib. Lay him off, mate.
So Masumba, it is before Maghrib. There's no chance you can come after Isha, no?
No. No joking. Straight after Amazon.
Okay. Okay. Can you use the interest that is paid into your bank account to pay towards charity via card, like a donation online? What does the cash need to be? I think she meant is, can you pay interest money to a charity?
Yes. So, you know, usually our teacher said that the interest money you get through your banks, just give it to a charity, be it through a bank or through cash, but with the intention of no reward, no thawab, because interest is haram in Islam. But of course, back in our mind, we know that Allah is rewarding, and through this gesture, Allah will reward us. So you give with the intention of no reward, hoping that Allah will help us through the blessing of it. So we should actually just get the interest of them and just give it to charity.
But we're not going
to
get
any
reward.
What if the bank uses the interest money, which you're not taking, to something else?
Yeah, but we're not going to get any reward for it.
But of course, do you think Allah won't reward you?
Yeah,
we're just giving without the intention of reward.
Ah, I see.
But of course, we have hope.
Okay. So give it, give the money, have intention, and who knows, Allah can reward you.
Yes, definitely.
Okay. Charity again. I know it's 2.5% of your personal earnings that you have to give zakat, but what about revenue of your own business? Is there a certain amount on revenue, example 2.5% also? Something so which I didn't know either.
Yeah, so zakat is not on revenue. It's on the profit. So revenue, as I was asking Shahjahan Bhai and Farid, that's after, revenue is before your expenses, right? Mm. So after you've done all your expenses, then whatever's left, that's when you do zakat on it.
That's the net.
Yeah, that was out of my league mind, because I don't know, I don't business mind.
So whatever you take in the business, so whatever profit you have at the end.
Yeah, after your expenditure.
After your expenditure, that's you could pay zakat on the business.
Yeah. We were talking about, remember, the zakat on the stock.
Yeah.
So I was explaining to Ramun, I think many people don't explain this. So say, for example, you have five partners, and zakat, you only give what you take.
Yeah.
Okay? But you don't realize that the stock you have in your business, you have to give zakat on that. So all the chicken, all the drink you have, and whatever you have. How much do you say? Like, for example, if somebody has...
Say if somebody has £2,000 worth of stock. So
yeah?
Chicken and stock and all that.
So you divide by how many partners?
Divide that by five. So it's five. Divide that by four, yeah?
Four.
So it's £500 each.
£500. Yeah. So everyone owns £500 worth of stock in that place. Yeah. So everyone has to give zakat on that £500.
It's £12.50.
£12.50. So everyone has to give £12.50. So if you have a restaurant or takeaway, then whatever stock you have, you need to give zakat on it. So be it drinks, be it vegetables,
chicken, vegetables,
meat,
chicken,
anything that represents money. So it's something that you can get money through.
Okay, there are two more questions. This is quite a long. This is quite a tricky one. But let me read it. Sheikh, I accidentally fell and a shawarma fell in my mouth with extra tahini and a slice of an apple, around 3 liters of water. Shall I carry on fasting, or has Allah fed me?
I'm going to do a Piers Morgan.
And the last one is, which you get every year.
Okay.
Is Taraweeh 8 or 20? Please tell the whole world.
I'm going back.
Oh, is this going? Don't go. I think... Every year, Imam Sahib got the same question, 8 or 20. I think everyone knows now. So if you're going to do 8 and go. If you're going to do 20, stay on 20.
Just pray. You know, this month of praying 20, would it break anything?
No.
Like, look at Uncle Shah. He's doing 20 rakats standing up, man. Learn something. 20 rakats. It's better than you standing outside or scrolling over Twitter or Instagram or Facebook. 20 rakats adding. You know, those 2 rakats extra, how many rakats? 12 rakats extra, equal to 12 first namaz outside Ramadan. So these are reward, you know. Just pray 20. So we're doing 10 instead of...
But anyway. Saudis doing 10?
Yeah.
Oh, they haven't gone back to 20.
But the 8 rakat, they read full Quran. The 10 rakat, they read full Quran. So we should be lucky, 20 rakat, you're getting a gap, a break.
Oh, they full Quran.
Yeah, so you're standing for long. So...
Okay, inshallah. Well, we do need another commercial break. We'll be right back after the break, inshallah.
Ramadan is a time for family, for community, and for reflection. It's a time to appreciate the blessings we have and to remember those who are less fortunate. The best of you are those who feed others. Ramadan is a time to strengthen the bonds of love and friendship. May this Ramadan bring you and your loved ones joy, peace, and blessings. Ramadan Mubarak from Crown Farms.
Casa Pizza, Port Harbor's freshly made stone-baked pizzas.
Ramadan is a time for family, for community, and for reflection. It's a time to appreciate the blessings we have and to remember those who are less fortunate. The best of you are those who feed others. Ramadan is a time to strengthen the bonds of love and friendship. May this Ramadan bring you and your loved ones joy, peace, and blessings. Ramadan Mubarak from Crown Farms.
Casa Pizza, Port Harbor's freshly made stone-baked pizzas.
حينما حل البلاء جئت إليك ذليلا أناجي من لي غيرك ربي يسمع مني شكواي من يستجيب الدعاء إلا الذي قد دعانا إليه من لي غيرك ربي معقود فيه رجايا لا تعاملني بذنبي يا جواد يا كريم إنني عبد ضعيف حظه لا يستقيم لا لا تحرمني ربي من لطفك العميم فسقامي أتعبتني يا ربي الرحيم قل له كن فيكون قل له كن فيكون.
Welcome back everyone. Assalamu alaikum. So Imam Sahab, everyone loves a little story about hadith. Can you tell us a little hadith?
Okay, so you know, one thing we all love, even though we deny it, one is wealth, and one is long life.
Yes.
Isn't it?
Yes.
I would love to have a longer life. I would love to have wealth, enjoy. But Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam given, of course we all have time. Like, you know, the angel, when we were 120 days in our mother's womb, the angel came down and he wrote down our time. But there's something that can change that. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that if you want longer life and you want more fulus, more money, more wealth,
yeah,
more S24 Ultra,
yes,
more holiday Sharm el Sheikh,
yeah.
Then you need to have good ties with your family.
Mm.
By having good ties, subhanAllah, it's our benefit. He says, learn about your family and have good ties with them. Allah will put barakah in your life. Allah will put barakah in your wealth. By just doing that.
That's it.
It's not easy though, because it's hard. But we should, you know. I always, you know, one thing I did was I had family tree, where I wanted to find out who's my granddad, who's his granddad, all the siblings. And it took me, like, I was shocked, not like I didn't know most of my family, and it's sad. So alhamdulillah, like that, I came to learn. So I would say, like, every father or every child should leave a family tree behind so that your children can go.
So do you know, say keep good ties with, is it just immediate family or extended?
Extended family as well. As long as they are your mahram.
Okay, mahram, yeah.
Yes. Like, if they're not mahram, then, like, for example, say you have a cousin sister. She's not your mahram, but she's poor. She's in Bangladesh. Mm. Help them. Charity starts from home.
You're right.
So the lesson we learn is have good ties with your family. Try to make a family tree.
Mm.
And if you have family which are in Bangladesh, Pakistan, India, Syria, anywhere, reach out to them, inshallah.
Jazakallah. I mean, talking about family trees, me and Nick Sambai started doing a family tree. I did tell you once, you know.
Mm.
We were amazed of how back can we went, you know, how back we went. And alhamdulillah, a lot of things we didn't know. But yeah, so that's very short hadith, but very... very good. So keep good ties with your family, family members, and you'll be able to go holiday and pull loose. Inshallah.
I guess a few announcements, inshallah.
Right, we got a few announcements. So this next 3 weeks is packed with information shows. So next week we have Dr. Patel. He was last year's shows.
Yeah.
And everyone loved him. He's a Tottenham supporter, unfortunately. That's the only down thing I would say. But he's coming on the show next week, 23rd. So if you have any questions regarding dietitian, mental health.
Like food diet during Ramadan or outside Ramadan or mental health, then, you know.
Please give the questions in. You can WhatsApp me, Imam Saab, or the number. Any questions for Dr. Saab, he'll answer your questions. That's next Saturday. And Madrasa today, don't forget, for the newcomers and the normal Madrasa. Saapas 2 till Apas 3?
Yeah.
Every Saturday, Sunday. Saturday, the 30th, it's my favorite one. We got the chair, Shazam Baisab. He'll be in the show. He'll be talking about Hajj. Everyone's asking me about Hajj. So this year and going forward, he'll explain exactly
how to book.
Rough estimate cost. So I'm happy that prices come down a bit, but he'll explain how much it come down and all that. And important one he'll talk about is funeral cost. So
mostly people don't know that, you know, when somebody from your family passes away, you need to cough out a lot. For example, 3,000, 4,000, 5,000. You know, you need to, like, so the expenses, like how much you need and what should you do, what are the steps you should take with somebody. You know, we're all going to pass away one day. So these are something we need to know. And inshallah, once he does this presentation, then we'll have a bigger poster and put it outside on the board of the masjid.
I think it's really important, the funeral cost as well, because we should know if something happens to us, we should leave the money for our kids, for them, because we don't want to put bogge on them. We don't want to put extra pressure on them. Mm. Right, they have to cough out thousands of pounds. So, inshallah, that's the 30th. Shazam Baisa will explain about Hajj and funeral. And next... the week after, that's the last show. We might get Amani, is it?
Yeah, Amani. So if everyone remembers Amani, who passed away due to cancer, her father and mother will be with us on the show. Just to say, like, you know, to speak to parents who how to recover if you have lost a child or someone, and how they are going on with their campaign.
So these next three shows will be packed with information. Please tune in. And next week also, our mosque accountant, Niaz, he'll also do, just like Imam Saab did, a
PowerPoint.
Yeah, PowerPoint. So Niaz will do a similar one with finance. How does mosque work with finance and stuff? So if you have any questions, please ask Niaz. Not me, not Imam Saab. Ask directly to Niaz. That's next week, inshallah. One last announcement before we call it a day. I really want to, this really means a lot to me. This person, Imam Saab will say the name, she's doing so much since this Palestine conflict. Every week, week in, week out, she does this vigil. She speaks a lot about Palestine in our town. Her name is, I call her Lulu Afa.
Sister Ashra?
Ashra.
Yes, so she works very hard. And, you know, her, be it rain or be it dry, she was there with her daughters and everyone with it. But, you know, credit to her. May Allah bless her and, you know, may Allah protect her and accept her efforts. But, you know, we should help her and support her. You know, she has been doing it for 5 months now.
5 months?
So yeah, every Sunday now, 2 p.m. So if your children come to Madrasa, before you drop your 2 p.m., so before Madrasa.
Yeah. Half an hour
but
before Madrasa.
Yes, so do support her and stand with her and, you know, make dua for her that, you know, she's doing an amazing job, you know, standing up for the people that are oppressed.
Oh, she is. And she's also looking for speakers. Anyone wants to speak, anyone wants to help out, so please get in touch with Afa. If you haven't got a number, you can get in touch through me or Imam Saab or the chair, Shazam Baisab, and we will get in touch with Afa. And please subscribe to our talk show.
Like, share, and subscribe.
Yeah, like, share, and subscribe to our talk show. So we're going to have a, I think this is it for this week, Imam Saab.
Yeah, Jazakallah khairan. And remember that we are collecting on behalf of One Nation. So next Friday, I think, Tahir, do you have the link? The Gaza, or we'll post it on our Facebook, on our Instagram.
Yeah.
Next week, we're collecting on behalf of all the people that are suffering in Palestine. Alhamdulillah, one of the trucks which we raise money has already been there. So we're trying to get another truck on behalf of Port Talbot. Please support, be it your zakat, sadqa, lillah, or anything. So next Friday, the masjid will be collecting, or you can donate online, which we'll be sharing the link, inshallah. Jazakallahu khairan.
Jazakallah from our team. Assalamu alaikum.
Break us, they cannot shake us, patiently waiting for guaranteed freedom. You can take our homes, but we will remain strong, cause Allah's on our side, and he's where we belong. Palestine, Palestine, wipe those tears from those saddened eyes. Palestine, Palestine, Jannah waits for your innocent life. Palestine, Palestine.